the first thing I did when I came on campus was I knew I wanted to be involved with the music industry in some way, whether that was going to be through writing or whether I was going to like end up being a publicist, but music was my passion. So the first thing I did was I joined ACRN, and that really helped me just kind of lay the groundwork for knowing what route to take or who to talk to even. I think for a lot of the time I was in school, there were a lot of different things being thrown at me, and I was afraid that I would have to compromise my identity to pursue them. And I think that the biggest takeaway I've had is that actually passion and being who you are and pursuing what you want to pursue is really important, and it'll get you places because people see that in you, and they notice it and they comment on it, and they kind of want that. Like, even now as a professional, like, if we see someone who is, you know, they're just, you know, going to school, like, maybe I'll try out your magazine, we wouldn't pick them over someone who says, oh, I love this band, I love this band, I love this band. And kind of, I mean, I look like our audience and I talk like them and I write stories that they relate to because I am one of them. And so often you'll kind of get told, like, you know, you have to, you know, put on a suit, do this, do that. And for a lot of things, you should put on a suit and you should be professional. But if that's not your bag, then you don't have to do that. You can take your own path and make your own path, essentially. It was actually really seamless for me because I was a senior who had yet to do my internship, which was my final requirement. So the summer that would have been after my senior year, I did my internship. I lived in Cleveland with my cousin, and I interned actually at the job that I eventually got. So it was actually very luckily easy for me. I've only been out for a year now. I've been at my job for a year now, and I've settled in really well. My primary job when I was an intern was sort of overlooking like the news posting on our website, and I was doing about 32 news posts a day, which is kind of crazy for a music website, especially on like Thursdays and Fridays because the industry slows down, but I'd like find something to write about. And I would just kind of always speak up in meetings. In weekly meetings, they always kind of asked, you know, do you have any input? And I would always try to have input. I'd take notes and I'd make note of things that I thought that, you know, they should be focusing on, whether it was, you know, upcoming artists or an angle of a story they might have forgotten. Like, I would always bring up those ideas rather than just kind of let them float away. I would speak up. I mean, now I've actually had the chance to have interns myself, and I kind of see what I did that they didn't, which was I just took so much initiative and I went above and beyond what anyone ever asked me to do. When I was a freshman, I actually started a blog myself, and my current job title is a web content manager. And I think working with the CMS of even a blogging platform like really helps you learn. I mean, there was a web editor above me when I was an intern, obviously. I now have his position, but you know, I could go in without him having to tell me how to do things. Like, rather than pitching and waiting for someone to publish me, I started publishing myself. And I worked with, on campus, ACRN, the All Campus Radio Network, and that sort of really helped me learn about the music industry and have those industry terms in mind. As I was working in music journalism, which you realize pretty quickly in music journalism that it's very closely tied to the music industry. So you're gonna want to have, you know, knowledge in mind of like, what does a promoter do? What's a publicist do? You know, anyone you work with. So basically just kind of taking my own route as a student and working independently to get my name out there and get just experience under my belt. Whether it was, some people you might not think it's like significant to write a blog post every now and then, but it really does help. As a freshman, I started a blog because my favorite band were between album cycles. And in the mainstream music media, there was a lot of misinformation happening. And as a fan, I kind of saw the fans reacting to that, like, really negatively. Like, it hurts us when bad information's out there because we're like, well, what's going on? Like, we believe it. And having been a fan of the band at that point for several years, a lot, I kind of knew their backstory, and I knew, like, their nature and, like, the path that they would take and what would make sense for them, as opposed to, you know, someone whose job it is to, like, write about music, and maybe they write about a lot of musicians. They don't necessarily understand the unique dynamics of the one. So I took my blog as an opportunity to get accurate, reliable information out there to fans about one specific band, and it grew itself, just like people naturally wanting to get good information when so much bad information had been out there. People latched onto it. I started a Twitter around the same time. This was 2008, so Twitter wasn't huge. I started my own Twitter, and then I started sort of a Twitter chat, which has currently like 11,000 followers, which is kind of ridiculous, but it was a hashtag-based chat that I started, and I would sometimes promote my blog entries there. And yeah, the audience they're just like me. Like, they're huge fans of this band, and they're all kind of looking for the same thing. They wanted someone who understood the band to speak about it. And yeah, I actually, currently on my personal Twitter account, I have 7,000 some followers, something like that, which is, you know, kind of crazy. Like, 7,000 people want to see me tweet about my lunch. But it's a lot of people are like, oh, you work for a major music magazine. Like, obviously those followers come from there, but they don't. It's still the My Chemical Romance fans coming to me. When I was a teenager, which a lot of my audience are teenagers, I was kind of like a sad kid. And I found something in their music that inspired me and gave me hope and a sort of direction in my life. And I really took it to heart. And then I kind of, over the years, was like, I want to give back to them in any way that I can. And so my little contribution, maybe helping out their fans and making sure their story's told accurately, sort of a big passion of mine. Like, I want to make sure that they are archived as they should be. Yeah, actually, that blog I mentioned earlier got the attention of the record label of my favorite band. And the beginning of my junior year, they put out their new album. Like I said, I started the blog when they were between album cycles, so I'd been heavily reporting on the entire rollout of their new album. And I got a call. I was actually in a history of rock and roll class. It was a Twitter direct message from their web community manager at the time. And he was like, hey, I'm going to email you. And I was like, what is this? Like, my heart was racing. I got back to my dorm, and the email was, you know, we want to fly you out to Los Angeles to listen to the new album. And I sort of had known about this listening party, but it was just for locals. But I and another blogger within the fan base got flown out to Los Angeles on Warner Brothers. And we got to visit the office. We got to listen to the album early. It was really amazing. I was like, I'm still surprised that happened. I love it. It's funny with them because they have all moved on to do different projects. So it's really exciting for me to get to cover the genesis of what they're doing next. Like, cause I was 11 when they started, so I didn't obviously get to cover the band from the beginning, but I get to cover what they're doing next from the very start. So I have every tiny bit of information that ever was about them right now in my brain, and some things that people don't know yet, which make me really happy. The insider part is like really interesting and special and strange. But not. It's about, for me, it's kind of just having the chance to document it all properly and in a way that I feel it deserves. Because they mean so much to me that I want their, like, I want their history to be preserved. And so this next chapter of their history to be involved in it and to be actively writing about it is just, that's a dream come true too. So many of these dream things happening. What? I have a binder of almost every press clipping they've ever done, like down to like little magazines. And I call it my MC archives. And it's really cool to get to be an MC archivist at this point. I actually, in my senior year, I did a content analysis of their entire written history in journalism, and I kind of analyzed how the media painted them to be versus how, you know, fans perceive them, how they perceive themselves. And it was interesting to me that, you know, how much of an angle, like one writer can throw in to a band's history and like change the complete perception of them. And it's kind of like, I want to keep it on track. Like, don't throw them over here. Don't throw them over here. This is what they are. This is their story. It's just, it's exciting to get to see them grow. I studied hard and I worked really hard the entire time I was here, and I wouldn't take back any of that. Maybe I would have left my dorm a little more often. not to do anything crazy, but, you know, just to experience more, but working hard paid off too. It's funny because, you know, I love my job at Alternative Press, and ever since I was little, I was a subscriber, and I always wanted to work for the magazine, so it's just kind of a dream come true. You know, I think that as long as they'll have me, I'd like to stick around there just because I do love it so much. But, you know, everything's always evolving there. Like, even the format of our magazine changed. We're moving more to mobile, and I'd love to see them through those changes and learn more and kind of adapt to those formats and see how journalism changes, really. And if I get to be with that company, I'd be really happy. There are plenty of bands that don't have this type of fan base. I think that the type of fan base they have is a very passionate one because they connect to them so personally. At least that's always kind of been, you know, my story. That's been the story that a lot of fans have told me. There are other bands that, you know, just kind of exist as bands. They don't really touch people that way, so people don't get so invested. And there's also sort of a generational thing. Like, I come from a time when bands weren't telling their own stories through social media, where everything that you read about them, you were reading from another person. And I think that for newer bands that have younger fan bases, it might be different because those bands or their publicists or their labels get to define their entire story, like on Facebook or through tweets. It's not necessarily a story that you have to pick up a magazine to read because they've put it out there themselves on Instagram or Vine or something. But yeah, I think that if any band that inspires passion in people are gonna have followers who are like me and like the other fans of My Chemical Romance, or, you know, whatever the next band may be that kind of brings people together and inspires something in them. It's really weird for me because, and not to like jinx myself or sound like, oh, I know good things are gonna happen to me, but there's a way the universe works that's sort of been in my favor sometimes. But I think that, you know, it's not all the universe. Like, back to the band and how they inspired hope in me when I was sort of in a dreary place in my life, I kind of have always been able to see, like, sort of like a glimmer of hope. But I know that, you know, a glimmer is just a glimmer if you don't chase it. It did everything that I needed to do to get where I am, which was just take my classes seriously, but also be involved and also work on my own, getting my own, publishing myself. I get to encounter so many jaded people just within the music industry, because everyone's like, I got shows like every day, I'm so sick of it. And meanwhile, I, you know, traveled to Columbus recently and waited in line for 9 hours for one of my favorite bands. Like, that's not going anywhere. Like, I'm still right there with the audience. Like, I get it. I think that helps too. When, you know, when it's a long running publication that I work for, and a lot of people have worked there for a long time and they've experienced a lot of things, but none of us are jaded. Like, we still love music. And I think that being a music journalist, you have to, or else you're gonna get really bummed out. Yeah, I think that I was lucky in that I've kind of always known what I really care about. But I mean, if you don't know what you care about just yet, that's fine. You just have to live life and explore and find something, you know, whether it's, you know, cooking or politics or sports or whatever you want, whatever, gardening, you know. Everyone loves something. You just have to find what it is. You know, this is something that people in life have gotten to do, so why not me? And it's maybe that's like hyper optimistic of me, but if you work towards something and you believe in it, I really think that you can achieve what you want to achieve. It's not, I mean, just like not kind of to sound hokey, but because a lot of people say that, and it's like, oh, in one ear and out the other, but it's true. I mean, if you have the investment in something, if you believe in it strongly enough, and if you're willing to work for it, then I think that you can do pretty much anything you want to do. Though I still am shocked that I get to work at my dream job.